Hey Art Family, if you like this one, the full-length version's on Patreon.
They are stupid.
For this demo, I wanted to do another ingredient video, where I sketch the ingredients to something that my son and I like to cook together. I'll be using M. Graham Gouache, Titanium White, Azo Yellow, Yellow Ochre, Naphthol Red, Alizarin Crimson, Ultramarine, Burnt Sienna, Burnt Umber, and Ivory Black. I'll also be using one of these handy sketchbooks that I like to make for gouache. It's made out of 186-pound mixed media paper from Strathmore that you can get in pads. I cut the pad in half and then take it to a nearby print shop and have them bind it. The paper is very thick, very sturdy, and it takes paint very, very well. It's also really cheap, which is nice. It comes in gray and brown tone. Now, the paper has a very absorbent but sort of smooth texture to it, so to knock that down, I do a kind of coating of very washed down thin gouache just to lay a kind of ground for the rest of the gouache. I find that gouache works best when it's sitting on top of other gouache, so I just lay down a kind of color to sort of set some tones. It's a little bit arbitrary. I tried to sort of ballpark some of those colors because in the end I like this to kind of shine through the cracks of the actual painting, so you get these little pops of color. That's the same reason I like to do my drawing on the underpainting in red, slightly red, a little bit kind of purpley color, so that on the cracks in between the actual painting you get these little kind of warm pops of color. I painted in the background, mostly this sort of general gray-white. I did that mainly to just set the stage for the value. I wanted to give myself a kind of light that I could start to compare the rest of my value structure against. And I did the shadow on this far right so that it would give me a little bit of a darker, so I could see a little bit further into the depths of the shadow and give myself a range to start building my relationships, because it's very difficult to tell when you're sitting at the very top, especially if you're using white paper, to see the full range of values that you're going to be able to get. A side note, the cast shadow in between the sugar and the cornstarch is a very saturated, warm shadow. And it gets that way because we have two bright yellow objects next to each other. So light will go down into that kind of crevice and bounce all around. So it generates a warm shadow. That's something you can pick up when you're painting from life. So it's always good to develop a good practice of painting from life and from photographs, because you can a lot of times photographs will crunch the light and the shadows, so you don't get to see all of that rich color that happens in shadows. So it's good to have a kind of cursory knowledge of the sort of color effects that happen with light, so that when you go to work from a photograph, in this case, you can bring some of that knowledge to your sketch and bring some of that knowledge to your work in general, in illustration or whatever other kind of painting projects that you'd be doing. So I'm trying to think of this lemon as the most simple shape as I can. It's just a sphere. So I'm treating it like you would a kind of rudimentary fundamental exercise with painting or drawing when you're working out the very basic shapes of a sphere or a cone or a cylinder and how light treats that object in space. So that's one of the benefits of working with fruit, is you have generally very simple shapes, circle, spheres, and light is treating them like a shape, the shape they are, so like a sphere in this case. So we have our highlight area, our halftones, and our terminator, the reflected light, and the cast shadows. So you're getting all those things, but you're also getting really rich, bright, vibrant coloration with fruit. And it's nice, it's a good experiment to put different fruit next to each other, because you get a lot of balanced light. So you get a lot of these colors that sort of get cast off onto other objects nearby, And that's another really good thing in developing your sort of library of color and the way light treats objects in three-dimensional space, is to work with fruit and develop that sense of what color is doing in a very intense situation, because you can bring that knowledge to landscape painting or anything else, really. Even architecture or portraiture, for example, because we're always trying to consider things in their most simple and concise shape as possible. The knife in this sketch was one of my favorite parts of this sketch, just piecing together all the little tiny objects. Overall, in a sketch like this, I'm generally thinking of it kind of like clicking together pieces of a puzzle. So I'm looking at little bits of the cutting board, the different simple facets of these shapes, the cubes, the spheres, as these little pieces of a puzzle that I'm just trying to click together, and I want to make sure that I'm getting all the major shape relationships working together as best as possible before subdividing into these smaller shapes. But the knife was a lot of fun in particular to work on, just because I really like, in an individual sketch, working on different types of materials. I think it's always good to try to get objects that have very directly reflective surfaces, like a knife would, where the surface is very smooth, so you get, you know, it's highly reflective, and then just sort of exploring the type of shapes that occur in the reflection, the way light bounces off an object and off this shiny object and then back to you, as opposed to the difference of the material difference between, say, the outside of the peach versus the inside of the peach, where the outside of the peach has a kind of fuzzy texture and you have a lot of like Lambertian reflection, which is when an object has a very bumpy, coarse surface, so light kind of gets scattered, so you have a very dull kind of matte surface because of that. But the inside is very shiny, and it's also similar to flesh or like butter or a candle that's been lit. You get a lot of subsurface scatter where light is going into the object and then kind of bouncing around a little bit, so you get this sort of luminescent glow. So it's always interesting to me in a sketch, even a simple sketch of just some ingredients, to try to think of different materials, because you can translate that knowledge to things like portraiture when you're trying to use your brushstrokes to communicate the difference in texture between, say, hair and flesh, and then the jacket or the shirt that the person is wearing, to just think about how light treats these different surfaces differently and how we can concisely communicate that with our brushstrokes. I'm trying to find a way to subtly communicate the difference in these colors and then the color of the other objects, because I was trying to intensify the saturation in the peaches because I wanted them to be more interesting than, say, the lemon, which was a little bit more of a green or yellow. And then the other objects were bright yellow, but I was trying to dull them down a little bit so they didn't quite take the main stage, like I wanted the peaches to take the main stage in this. But I was trying to focus also on continuing to be fairly loose with the sketch. And when I say loose, I mean as concise as possible with my brushstrokes as a storytelling tool, in this case, trying to show these objects. So I do that by closing an eye and squinting and trying to be as concise as possible about putting in these brushstrokes and how they interconnect with one another. I talk to a lot of people who tell me they're trying to develop a looser style, or that they feel like they focus too much on details and they want to get a more loose style, which I understand. That was a conscious choice I made at one point in time, because as I was learning painting, I was studying artists who were more detail oriented than I was. And so I would copy their paintings and copy it like to the brushstroke just to learn how to paint. And then after a while, I felt like I was just creating sketches that were just watered down versions of those artists' paintings. And I felt like I needed to branch out. So I started studying people who have much, much looser, more fluid strokes, like Alvaro Castanet or Joseph Spukvik, or even my all-time favorite watercolor artist is James Fletcher Watson. who is an architect, or was an architect, and is capable of very precise detail, but his watercolor paintings are very poetic. They're very kind of loose and sometimes kind of somber, very poetic paintings. And I really liked the way he handled his brush strokes, and I learned a lot from him about loosening up. But I've been giving that a lot of consideration lately because I was reading a book by Charles Reed on painting, and he talks, because he had a very loose style when he wanted to be loose, and he talks a lot about how, in the book, about how his students will tell him that they want to be looser painters than what they're currently doing. And he would tell them often that maybe, you know, a lot of times your painting is a reflection of your personality, and the sketches you make can be a reflection of your personality. So maybe you, as a person, are more detail-oriented, and there's nothing wrong with that. And there's nothing wrong with a more detail-oriented painting if that's the person you are. Maybe you're just that type of person. And that made me feel even more strongly about painting kind of chunkier, more loose brush strokes, because that tends to be how I am as a person. I'm not a very detail-oriented person. I tend to be a very big picture person, to a fault, really, when it comes to making plans or organizing things. And I feel like my sketches reflect that sense of my personality, and that's a direction that I've taken my sketches consciously and will probably continue to take in that direction and sort of explore where that can go and what type of storytelling tool that can be used for. Now that I've laid the groundwork for the kind of design of the knife and the design of those shapes and how they were put in, it's now time to get to the kind of the fun part of working on that knife, which is just figuring out how these objects reflect on the knife and then back to me. So it's kind of really a fascinating kind of exploration of how this one piece of the wedge was sitting on it, so it had like a direct reflection, but then the other one, the wedge, was sitting at an angle, so it and the cornstarch can or whatever got like a very kind of scrunched look to it. So it was kind of interesting to explore those things, and also some of those deeper reds that were getting caught in the hilt of the knife. At this stage, I was getting really caught up in the details, and that thing I've said is kind of a trap, and I had looked up and I totally realized I had completely forgot the baking powder. So I put in the baking powder on the left over there, and then that threw off, I felt like, the value relationship to the rest of the sketch. All of a sudden, it didn't pop as much as it was earlier, and so I decided to go ahead and darken the background a little bit more so that you'd get more of a kind of play off of the lights in the sugar bag and in the peaches, so that you would get more of a push forward, and then bring some of that light back in, kind of raking across the scene to give a sense that light was pushing down on it. And I kept it as loose as I could just to get the strokes in, and towards the end I come back in with a clean water brush and just sort of knock back some of that distracting texture and loosen up that area, because my goal is to keep that area more loose. The further out from the object of interest, I'm trying to keep loose, the strokes kind of fat and loose and less considered, and then more blurred, like the edges. I want the edges to be softer and less important. And then as you get closer to the objects of interest, I want to kind of increase the value relationships, increase the harshness of the edges, so you get more hard edges towards the center of the sketch. And you can do that with gouache really well, because gouache gets this kind of like flaky sort of like look as it goes out towards the edges. On a soft edge, you can get like a nice soft edge wrapping a form or coming off of a form, because gouache has a tendency to kind of fall apart, which is kind of nice, I find. Or like with oil tends to just blend and blur, and the more you work with it, the more blurry it gets, where gouache has this, you know, kind of crumbly look to it as you if you treat it loosely. So as you can see at this stage, I have switched to the smaller brush from the 1-inch flat. I'm working much bigger than I usually do. I usually work on crescent 100 board cut down to about 4x6 or 5x7, kind of postcard size. But these sketchbooks come from 9x12, and I cut down the whole sketchbook in half and then make the little sketchbooks out of it. So you can see how it kind of is a little less chunky than my sketches usually are, because the 1-inch doesn't quite carry the same thickness as it usually does. So that's going to be it for this demonstration. I'll leave a link for the ingredients and the recipe for this peach cobbler if you're interested in making it. It's a fun one to make. And thanks for watching. I really appreciate it. I appreciate the continued comments and relationships I've made on here. And I look forward to talking to you and seeing you in the next video. In the meantime, happy sketching.